Hello, podcast listeners, and welcome to the first episode of 2014. We've talked a lot about how important calories are for getting lean. As you know, there are two ways to create a caloric deficit. You can eat fewer calories, or you can burn more calories. In this podcast, we're going to talk about which method is better. Tom Venuto, one of the most trustworthy experts in the fitness industry, a bodybuilder, and an author, comes on the show to talk about what the research has shown are the pros and cons of both eating less and moving more for losing fat. We also talk about some other important tips to help you get lean with less effort. My name is Army Legg, and you're listening to Evidence Radio, the podcast that gives you simple, science-based tips to improve your health, fitness, and productivity. If you like what you hear in today's show, here's how to get more like it. Go to www.evidencemag.com. That's EVIDENCEmag.com. Enter your email address in the box on the right side of the page and click the button below. After you do, you'll get free updates from Evidence Magazine delivered to your email inbox when they are published. So, what the hell is Evidence Magazine? I've decided to change the name of Improvism to Evidence Magazine for several reasons. Number one, people can spell it and pronounce it, which was rarely the case with Improvism. Two, Improvism was a word I made up because it looked kind of like improvement, it sounded cool, and it was available as a web address. It also didn't do a great job of telling people what the site was about. 3. On February 3rd, 2014, I'm launching a digital magazine. The magazine will be integrated into evidencemag.com as a membership site. When you register as a member, you'll get access to the latest issues of the magazine. The magazine itself will be readable on any device, such as your smartphone, your tablet, your laptop, or your desktop. I may even make it available on Kindle and iBooks as well. Here's how you should think of Evidence Magazine now. The blog is the free content from the magazine, what you know as Improvism. And the membership site is the paid part of the magazine. The podcast stays the same. I'm just changing the name to make it consistent. Some of the best fitness authors and experts in the industry are contributing, including Tom Venuto. And it's easily the biggest project I've ever done. If you're interested in getting a special discount on Evidence Magazine before anyone else, you should sign up for the Evidence Magazine email updates. You can sign up by going to evidencemag.com/email updates. Tom, welcome to the show and thank you for taking the time to come on. Would you give our listeners a quick rundown on who you are and what you do?
Sure. Well, I've been in the fitness industry for almost 25 years now. And myself, I've been training for over 30 years. I started when I was 14. But I definitely wasn't always in shape, though. In fact, the whole reason I started lifting in high school is because I had no build to speak of. And I wasn't obese or anything, but I was pretty flabby, self-conscious. So I took up lifting in high school, trained through high school, and then I went to college, gained 20 pounds of fat right on my gut from drinking beer and eating pizza. But what happened is guys in the gym inspired me, and I got my act together before I graduated. I got my degree in exercise science. And after that, I was a competitive bodybuilder and personal trainer for almost 15 years. And today I'm still training people, but I do it online through my fitness websites and my Burn the Fat community. And I'm also a writer and author of two books on fat loss, including Burn the Fat, Feed the Muscle.
You are certainly a veteran and you're one of the people I've been following for a long time. And you've definitely influenced a lot of my work. And since you are so experienced, you get, I'm sure, a ton of questions. And one of the ones that's been popping up a lot more recently is whether or not people should eat less or exercise more to lose weight or lose fat. How do you normally answer that question?
Well, first of all, that is the question, isn't it? I mean, that's the big question that kind of sits on top of the whole fat loss thing. And I've noticed the trend myself. Surprisingly, a lot of people, even in the fitness industry, who are suggesting that, well, maybe exercise isn't all that effective. So I've taken an interest in this topic myself. And I think, first of all, there's a better thing to focus on than eat less and exercise more. And I would say that's focus on the deficit if your goal is fat loss. And the reason I say that is because somebody could eat less, but if you compensate by moving less, then you cancel your deficit, right? And you could exercise more, but if you compensate by eating more, again, you cancel your deficit on that side. So I think we can really only answer this question the right way if we establish that first, that whether we want to eat less or exercise more, if it's weight loss or fat loss, that's our goal. That's only a means. Each one of those is a means to an end, because what we're really after is that deficit. But what, how I would answer that normally is, in an ideal situation, you'd use both. I mean, the way I look at it is, if there's two sides on the energy balance equation, why would you handicap yourself by using only one side? Kind of like stepping into the ring with one arm tied behind your back. I mean, you know, you can fight with one hand, but I don't know why you'd want to. You can do more damage with both fists. And that's kind of how I see fat loss. You know, why not drop the calories down from the food intake a little bit and burn more calories from the exercise side?
That's a great analogy. So our listeners on this podcast generally tend to be a little obsessive. So when they hear, you know, do both, I'm sure a few people listening to this are thinking, okay, got to just go out there and, you know, run marathons and eat nothing. So I'm sure there are some pros and cons to both approaches for different people. And just like a boxer who might be right-handed or left-handed, they might want to emphasize one over the other. How would you help somebody decide which one maybe to use more or integrate in a different way?
Well, there are pros and cons of both sides, for one thing. Let's look at the pros of the eating less side, the use the nutrition side of the equation. The thing here is, there is pretty much a universal agreement that this is the primary thing to start focusing on. Like, even if you ask all the experts, even the trainers, I mean, on that side, it's not the diet industry, it's the training and fitness industry. You ask a trainer, their whole career is dedicated to preaching about exercise. But most of them are all going to tell you that nutrition is the most important. And there's two big reasons for that. And one is that when you're first starting out, it's a lot easier to create a significant calorie deficit, at least the initial deficit, you know, when you're starting out at maintenance, by cutting down your food intake. Because, like, if you compare the amount of work it takes to burn, say, 500 or 750 or 1,000 calories a day with formal exercise versus just dropping your food intake down by 500 or 750 calories, there's really no contest there. It's easier to just drop your food down. That's an easy way to get started. So that's one pro. And the other thing is, I think it's really important to point out that people can lose weight with no exercise. So it's important to know that exercise is not an absolute requirement to lose weight. Again, it's the deficit that we need. I mean, look at, there's patients lying in a hospital bed who lose weight because sometimes they just can't get food down. And that's as inactive as you get, you know, but is that the ideal way to do it, to just cut calories and not exercise? I mean, that's the question. Then on the other side, the second reason really comes back to, you know, the quote we always hear, it's on every Twitter and Facebook stream, you can't out-train a lousy diet. You know, it is a cliche, and it's a little vague, and, you know, some people don't like cliches. So let me clarify what I think is the accurate part of that. The reason people say you can't out-train a lousy diet, because it's not only possible, it's easy to out-eat any amount of exercise if you're not focused on that deficit. You know, if you're not watching the balance between the amount you're exercising and the amount you're eating, you can just be in it. You can just cancel everything out just by eating more. You know, and it's hard for a lot of people to grasp this, because it feels like they're working so hard in the gym. So they say to themselves, well, there's no way I can undo that workout with one visit to McDonald's or Dunkin' Donuts. And yeah, you can. You know, basically working out, it's not a free license to eat as much as you want.
Bummer. Yeah. So what are some of the pros of the exercise side? You know, we talked about eating less. What benefits does exercise have to offer?
Well, okay, let's take a look at the cardio, for example. One way I like to look at cardio is, I don't say that it's absolutely mandatory. I see it as a fat loss accelerator. So let's say you've got your nutrition in place and you're consistent with the nutrition. Whatever result you're getting with your diet side of things, you add cardio on top, you're going to burn fat faster. As long as you don't compensate, as long as you don't eat more when you exercise more. And then the weight training side, I mean, the weight training has so many other benefits even outside of fat loss. I mean, for one thing, a lot of people overlook that weight training burns a lot of calories, for one thing. But also, that's where your strength comes from. That's where, that's how you sculpt your body, your body shape. I mean, from a bodybuilding background, for me, it's a no-brainer, but other people just don't see all the benefits of adding weight training into a fat loss program. For some people, it doesn't even compute, which I find kind of odd. I get that question all the time. Someone's like, my goal is to lose weight. Why should I lift? And it's like, well, duh. but it, a lot of people, it just doesn't, it doesn't click. So I think that combination, I like to separate the training into two distinct styles, you know, like cardio training and weight training. And I think you should combine both along with nutrition. So nutrition, cardio training, weight training, it's a 1-2-3 punch. And, you know, my system, I add one more element. I add the motivation psychology side on top of that. So you put those four elements together and I think you got the full package.
We'll definitely talk about some of the behavioral and psychological aspects of dieting on maybe on a different podcast or later. But in the meantime, what are some of the negatives or the problems people run into when trying to just eat less? You mentioned how often it's just compensated for by lack of physical activity. Are there any other problems people might run into if they just try to eat less and go about weight loss that way?
For sure. Well, the cons are, okay, if you want faster fat loss, you want a bigger deficit, but you can only cut calories so far before bad stuff starts to happen. You get hungry. Hunger is the big one. That's a big problem for a lot of people. You get tired, you get irritable. If the restriction goes on for a long time and the more severe it is, there is some degree of metabolic adaptation and the hormones get affected in a couple of directions. It's like these hormones are conspiring against you in two directions. So you have the hormones that maintain a healthy metabolic rate will drop and the hormones that increase hunger will go up. So you're kind of prompted to want to eat more while at the same time you're burning less than you normally would. Another one, a lot of people don't think about this, is it has to do with NEAT, with the non-exercise activity thermogenesis. That's all that the activity and the walking and stuff you do outside of the gym. People don't realize how much that really adds up over the course of the day. And when you're on really restrictive diets, what some of the studies have found is that your NEAT level drops spontaneously and you don't even realize it. So what happens is you're moving less during the day and you're burning less that way too. So there's all these kinds of compensations going on that you don't notice. And that's what really leads people to a plateau. The overeating, the drop in activity. Some people, when they just do the diet only approach, they actually end up eating more and burning less. And then they say, well, you know, this diet's not working. I've got this mysterious fat loss plateau. But I mean, there's your explanation for it right there.
Interesting. So let's say we have somebody who actually does establish an extremely large deficit. Are there any other problems that can cause? You mentioned metabolic slowdown, but what kind of effect does that have on their activity level or exercise ability?
Well, I mean, yeah, you don't have as much gusto in the gym. You can't train as hard. That's part of the energy level dropping. And really, we have to look at what's going to happen to your body composition, especially if you can't train as hard. But I mean, diet alone is never going to give you as good of a body composition outcome as nutrition combined with training. And really, if you can't train hard, the weight training is so crucial for retaining lean body mass when you're in a deficit. I mean, the bigger the deficit, the greater the risk of muscle loss. But I mean, just the training alone goes, the resistance training alone goes a long way to protecting your lean body mass.
Tom, I would give you a high five right now if we were in person. You are the first person to use the word gusto on the podcast. So way to have a vocabulary, man. Good job. So what are some of the mistakes that people make when strength training for fat loss or training in general, actually, for fat loss?
Well, you know, a lot of people just go through the motions. There's no intensity of effort. There's no mental focus. Like, they've got a list of exercises and they've got a certain number of sets and prescribed reps that they do, but they're never pushing the edges of their comfort zone. And they're not mentally focused either. I mean, you walk into the gym, it's crazy how many people have cell phones between sets. I mean, it's like, what happened to the mental concentration that the guys in the old days used to teach? It was almost like a Zen type of thing, where, you know, it was just all about, I mean, this is what I like about the bodybuilding world still to this day, is the way that those guys would work on that mind to muscle connection. And for other people, it's just, you know, lift weight up, lift weight down. I mean, and it's the same thing on the cardio side of things. If you're training for fat loss, a lot of people, they go through the motions in the sense that they never put any intensity into their training. And a lot of people, here's a big mistake, is they just look at the clock as opposed to say, you know, just coming full circle and going back to this calorie thing. They figure, well, if I clock 60 minutes, I'm guaranteed to lose fat. But whereas if they were focusing more on the intensity and the amount of calories that they burned, I mean, they could burn just as many calories in 30 minutes if they pushed themselves harder.
Great point. Great point. So what are some ways people can use to make counting calories and macros easier? Are there any tricks that you've learned over the years or that you use with your clients?
Well, it's easier today than ever before because of all the software and the apps that we have available. I mean, they're right there on your computers or on your iPads, they're on your smartphone. You know what I did? I built meal planning software for my members, and it's not a mobile app. It's a piece of software. I kind of did that as a benefit for our members, but there's so many options. And before we had all this, I just used an Excel spreadsheet. Hmm. You know, I would, my good old Microsoft Excel. And what I would do was, I would call it meal planning and not calorie counting. I see a distinction there. And, you know, I prefer to be proactive. I get on my meal planner software or spreadsheet and I create a meal plan in advance. And I pick the foods that I want and I drop them into the software or the sheet. And then I'll go to the amount section and I'll just tweak the serving size to get the macros and the calories I want. And then, you know, if I need to, I'll look at the subtotal for each meal and the total for each day, and I'll just tweak it to, you know, to get it close. I'm not a macronutrient micromanager or anything, but the whole goal was to have my daily meal plan on paper. And it was a goal. It was like an eating goal for the day. And then I just followed what was on the meal plan. And all I had to do was weigh and measure my food. And that's how I really learned nutrition and learned to understand calories and protein and carbs and fats. And it's not the only way to do it. The other way people are doing it is they're kind of doing it on the fly, where they'll eat something, write it down, eat something, write it down. And that works too. I know a lot of people who are just into the, you know, hitting their macros and calories by the end of the day. And that works for them. But to me, that's also reactive. And I think there's more margin for error or getting off of what your original plan was or having to make some strange last minute changes or compensations as the day goes on. So I really like the meal planning method. It's planning. It's knowing what you're going to eat each day in advance. And even if you're out on the road, you're traveling, I mean, you know what you're supposed to eat, and it just makes it a lot easier.
And of course, you can always change it too if you feel like it. You know, there's no reason.
Right.
Yeah. All right. So basically, your approach is to list the foods that you want to have throughout the day and then just tweak the amounts to make sure you're in line with your calorie and macronutrient goals.
Exactly. Yeah. Basically, all my meal plan is on paper. And if I get bored, I'll change it. I'll have several menus, or I'll just do a swap. I'll do an exchange for an approximate. Like if a breakfast for me is typically eggs and oatmeal, a piece of fruit. And if I want something quicker and easier, instead of the eggs, that's just the lean protein group. I'll just drop some protein powder in my oatmeal and stir it in. And I'm right in the same ballpark with just one little substitution. So exchanges and substitutions is really easy with that system too.
Right. It seems like it would also make it very easy. Let's say, as you mentioned, if you're traveling and you can't weigh your food for whatever reason, or you just get so tired of it, you want to take a few days off. If you're sticking to roughly the same amounts, if you've been weighing it for a while and eyeballing it, it's pretty easy to go on autopilot for a few days too, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, absolutely. In fact, I think that's exactly what happens when you go through this process. It does go autopilot after a while.
Mm. So what other psychological tips would you have for people who are struggling to stick to their diet and exercise program?
Well, get rid of the triggers for one thing. There's a lot of the way the whole world and the environment is set up today is we're triggered to eat all the time. And there's all kinds of triggers. Some of them are internal, you know, in your mind, emotions, stress, you know, just fatigue, all kinds of things will trigger us to eat. But, you know, things in the environment. And I think a good place to start is right in your own home, is get rid of eating triggers in your home. And the simplest way to do that is just do a kitchen sweep and don't keep junk food in your house. It's so simple, but I'm just shocked at how many people, you know, the cheat day is coming up and they stockpile junk food in their house. And I would go a step further and take it in the opposite direction, where, you know, I'm kind of the philosophy that out of sight, out of mind. You know, if you don't see it, you're not going to eat it. And if you do see it, you are going to eat it. So, I mean, I'm looking here at my kitchen right now and I'm seeing bowls of fruit. There's apples, there's bananas. I actually have my tub of oatmeal over there in the corner. There's a container with potatoes and one with sweet potatoes. So, I mean, what I see every day is healthy triggers. I'm surrounded by healthy triggers every day. And, you know, not everybody has that kind of control over all of their environment, like, you know, at work and, you know, what can we do outside? But take control of what you can control, do control it. And that's a good place to start, is right in your own home.
Mm. So on the exercise side of things, what are some of the reasons that people either won't stick to an exercise program or will stop tracking their workouts or trying to improve?
Well, lacking accountability is a big one. I mean, you said stop tracking your workouts, and continuing to track your workouts, I find, is one of the most important things to help people stick with it. I mean, in terms of sticking with it and motivation, I mean, a few of the top three things I can think of include having a very clear goal, always having a goal, and not only any goal, it's a big goal that motivates you and it's compelling, and you have a strong reason why that you want to achieve it. And then you have an accountability system, and then you have some support. And the way the accountability works is, first, just be accountable to yourself. And that just means keep score. Everything you want to improve, track it. I mean, I'm a really big believer of tracking by the numbers. And, you know, again, you don't have to do that forever. Eventually things do become kind of unconscious, competent, or intuitive. But especially if you're struggling with body fat or you just stuck at a plateau, I think everything you want to improve, you should track. Track your, you know, again, track your, the nutrition, your calories, protein, carbs, fats. Track your body composition each week. If you want to lose body fat, track your body fat. If you want to gain muscle, track your lean body mass, track your weight. I like to keep a progress chart every week. And so, let's say every Monday might be a check-in day. It's accountability day. And you log in your results for each week. And it does a couple things. It's a navigation system, for one thing. Because if you get the results you wanted, you know that everything you did in the previous week, you got it right. And you don't change anything. You keep doing it. And if you didn't get the results you wanted, then you know you have to make a change. So you can go back and look at the past week and see if, first of all, check your compliance level. Did you really follow the plan that you had? And if you did follow it, then you just make a change. So it's an accountability system, and it's just a phenomenal motivator. And then to take that to the next level, you just get a support partner. You get support, a person, a coach, a trainer, a friend, family member, plug into a community and take that, you're keeping score, you take those numbers and you show it to somebody else. And that's been one of the most powerful techniques for sticking with it that I've ever seen. And it's probably one of the first places that I'd start recommending. If somebody's really stuck, just ask yourself, am I accountable?
You have a great article on that on your website as well that I'll make sure is in the show notes. And for anyone listening to this, there's a cool app, since we were talking about technology, that a friend of mine made called Goal Hawk, which you can plug in pretty much any weight and it'll send it to a group of your friends, or any goal, and it'll send it to a group of your friends and they can pitch in and get updates on it. So that might be something people would like to check out. So when you set a goal with a client, or when anyone sets a goal, how do you kind of reverse engineer the plan around that goal in terms of diet and training? What is your process?
Well, that's a good way of saying it, reverse engineer. Because you start with the end in mind. I like Stephen Covey put it. You have to have the goal first before you really can engineer a program. I mean, how do you know what program to follow if you don't know what your goals are? So you set the goal first, and that helps you decide what kind of training program to follow in the first place. And people ask me, hey, what, I'm so confused about how to work out. What kind of workout program should I follow? I'm like, I don't know. What are your goals? Do you want to compete in bodybuilding? Do you want to just lose fat? And, you know, at the same time, you have to factor in a person's experience level too, because it would be different for a beginner or advanced. But I like to set goals on many, many levels. I mean, obviously long-term and short-term. I'd like to start even with the big picture. You know, what's your ultimate ideal body? I think it's a great place to start. And that's going to keep, you know, that for a lot of people, that'll keep them busy for a long time. Setting up goals for, you know, a 3-month period. I mean, you see all these fitness challenges for 12 weeks, and I don't think it's a coincidence a lot of people pick that time frame, because you can make some pretty measurable results in that amount of time. And then it's not so long that you lose motivation, because if you think about, you know, a year or more in advance, it's so far away, you lose the urgency factor. And then what you do is just keep backtracking to shorter term goals. Those weekly goals, those accountability checkups, that's actually a goal. You can break it down to the weekly level and down to the daily level. I think it's important. I'm a proponent of having both types of goals, of having outcome goals and performance goals. I think that's the best of both worlds. So you set goals for weight and body composition, and visually, do you have that image of the body that you want? I'm all for that. And I think you also need to have action steps of what you're going to do every day so you can break it right down to the daily goals. And if you do it that way, it's like that old saying, you know, how do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. You have to break it. You have to break it down. Otherwise, those big giant goals get intimidating. But I do think you need the big goals. I think the goals for what you really want, not just what you think you can get, is what motivates you.
Interesting. So before we finish up, let's talk a little bit about some of these specific questions that often pop up around what kind of exercise or dieting to follow. So in terms of exercise, something people are always talking about now is high intensity interval training. And there's been more of a push against lower intensity cardio. Do you integrate those two into your training programs?
Both. Yeah, I integrate both. I think it depends on a person's goals, the time that they have available, their personal preferences. Do they have any orthopedic problems or health problems? I mean, I don't think it's an either or thing. It's again, what are your goals? What's your individual situation? And then you can make the right prescription. If somebody has no limitations at all, the big advantage of the high intensity is efficiency, time efficiency, arguably more effective too. But I mean, 45 minutes or 60 minutes of medium or low intensity cardio, it helps. It takes longer to burn the same amount of calories. So, I mean, I just see the higher intensity work as being much more efficient. One of the things I noticed in the research that's interesting is how much cardiovascular improvement you can get in a pretty short amount of time with intense training. Some of those studies are, I mean, pretty amazing. I mean, really short workouts were producing some substantial increases in cardiovascular health and cardiovascular fitness. And when you just don't push at all, when all you do, say, is walking, you don't get those kind of benefits. But, you know, I've also seen people go from obese to a healthy body weight doing nothing but walking. So, I mean, it both works. I mean, again, it's all part of the energy balance equation. So, you know, the busy person, I think, is the one who's really going to want to emphasize if they're able to do higher intensity cardio, emphasize the higher intensity work because they're going to get done faster.
On the nutritional side of things, what are some of the bigger changes that clients often end up needing to make when they're trying to get leaner, either in terms of macronutrition and calories or food quality?
Well, you mentioned food quality. I tell you what I think a lot of people are overlooking. And if we wanted to, we could blame the diet industry because they're really promoting this attitude is that it's either about food quantity or it's about food quality. So you've got one camp that's, it's all about food quantity. It's just calories in versus calories out. That's the only thing that matters. And then you've got the other camp and it's just food quality. And they say, hey, just eat the healthy foods or whatever camp they're in. It's organic or it's, you know, whatever. Just eat the healthy stuff and you'll automatically lose weight. And from everything we talked about earlier, you know, about energy balance and caloric deficits, we know that's not true. You can get fat on healthy food. So, I mean, I think that's a dichotomy that people have to get out of. And, you know, this is such a big message is that you want to focus on food quantity and food quality. And when you get both of those right, that's when you'll get leaner and you'll get healthier.
Great point. And I think it's also important to remember that both food quality and quantity influence each other. So, you know, when the one most people get is, okay, like Pop-Tarts are less filling than sweet potatoes. So generally it's easier to lose weight if you eat more filling foods. But on the other hand, it's often easier for people to eat less without really missing it as much if they're also being a little more diligent about tracking their food intake as well. So both of those can kind of work together nicely, I think.
Yeah, I agree. And certain foods are so much more palatable too. That is just so easy to overeat them. So yeah, that's a good point.
Yeah. Pop-Tarts are deadly, man. They're so good. So Tom, thank you so much for taking the time to come on the show. Would you tell our listeners where they can learn more about your work and maybe tell us a little bit about your new book as well?
Sure. My main homepage is burnthefatblog.com. I just released the book. Actually, I would say it's an old book. It's Burn the Fat, Feed the Muscle. Has been out for 10 years. I first published it as an ebook in 2003. And it has continued to be popular for 10 years. And there's been just a tremendous demand for, hey, put it into print. So we just published it last week in a hardcover and it's available in bookstores everywhere, Amazon and Barnes and Noble. And the new site is burnthefatfeedthemuscle.com. And really it's about the techniques of fitness models and bodybuilders but it's not just for bodybuilders. You know, it's not about becoming a bodybuilder or getting ripped unless you want to. It's just about how the average person can take some of those techniques and use it to reach their own goals. You know, anything, whether it's 100 pounds, they want to lose the last 10 pounds, or whether somebody actually wants to put on muscle, or just they describe their goal as getting more toned. And since it's already been out there for 10 years, we've seen over 250,000 people already use it. And it's regular people, you know, only a small amount of our readers and clients are actually bodybuilders. So it's been proven out in the real world. And the other thing we have going on is we run a Burn the Fat Body Transformation Challenge every year, and that's burnthefatchallenge.com. And that's coming up in January. We're going to do a new year, a new you challenge. And that's a great motivator for people, because that's a way for people to get that accountability that I was talking about before.
Excellent. Excellent. I have your book on my Amazon wish list. So
all right,
I'm definitely going to get it, and I'm excited. So thank you. And thank you for coming on the show. You were excellent.
Thank you.
Yeah. You did it with gusto. Did you enjoy this episode as much as I did? Good. Then go to evidencemag.com/iTunes and leave the show a ranking. You're going to see a lot more changes to evidencemag.com in the near future, and I can't wait to share them with you. It is going to be big.